weaponless fashioned against us will stand. The battle belongs to the Lord, and we sing glory.
The standard, the power of his blood.
The battle belongs to the Lord, and we sing glory.
Good morning and welcome to Harbor Christian Fellowship. Glad you're here today. We got a holiday weekend, so we got a little extra time at the end of the week. What are you saying? You can't hear me? John, my wife says the mic sounds weird. Everybody else agree with that? No? I know it's got too much bass in it. That's what I think. Let's stand up and sing America the Beautiful. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountains, majesty above the fruited plain. Shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Oh, beautiful for pilgrim's feet where stern impassioned strands, a thoroughfare for freedom be across the America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Oh, beautiful for people's good in liberating strife, who more than self their country and mercy more than life. America, America, may God thy gold refine, till all success be nobleness and every grain divine. Oh, beautiful for painted stream that sees beyond the years, thine alabaster sins, undimmed by human tears. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shine. Just don't sing that often enough, do we? We need to know the words. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, church family. You know, one of the founding fathers, I believe it was Mason, said, our country was built for a holy and moral people. Without such, it will not succeed. Amen? That's incredible. And the Bible is found throughout the word of God is found throughout our government. If you look at the Supreme Court, it has in marble Moses and the Ten Commandments. Behind the speaker at a house desk is the same thing. And the Supreme Court did a great thing in celebrating and passing laws that strengthen that. It's separation of church and state, not separation from. The founding fathers wanted to make sure that we could celebrate and worship freely, not to have a religion as they had in Britain, where it was the king's religion. But they believed that you could worship anyone you wanted to, but they believed that Christianity was so much better that anybody who heard it would eventually decide to come and worship the true living God. Amen? So when they ask you separation of church and state, that's nowhere in the Constitution, it's nowhere in the Bill of Rights. It was said when Jefferson, the Baptist, had asked him, are we going to have a state religion? And he said, no, we're not. There should be this separation between church and state. But was the government should never tell you where to worship or how to worship, because that's the freedoms that we have. And when you read our Constitution, all men are created equal, that our rights come from God. You cannot deny the fact that Christianity is inherently a part of the American fiber and the American system of law and justice. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. So with that, let's go to open up with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you. As we celebrate the foundings of this country, Lord, as we look at the founding fathers who put their lives, put their fortune, put everything into you to find this country for religious freedoms. Lord, we just thank you that you gave these men the insight that your spirit directed them, such as Washington, when leading the army and all else was failing, time and time again he turned to you. And upon his inauguration, after he was inaugurated, he took both houses, the Senate and the Congress, to the National Cathedral, and they celebrated you for 3 hours. What a tremendous, tremendous worship service that was. And Lord, it's on that foundation, it's on that basis for what your spirit laid in these men's hearts that we celebrate on the 4th, that we celebrate every day these freedoms that you have given, their acknowledgement of that. And we today acknowledge the same thing. Lord, we pray this morning that our worship will be pleasing to you, for it's you who we come to celebrate and honor. Lord, I pray that you'll embolden Pastor Jonathan with your words. May your spirit ring out. Open our ears and open our hearts that we will celebrate you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. There are no strangers here, just friends we haven't met. And Pastor Talbert, our first pastor, said that. Would you take a moment to tell people that God loves you and give them a good hug? Amen.
Thank you.
As we continue with the worship service, we are going to have the food bank start next Saturday, and we're up over about 35 people who are coming to the food bank, and a great way to offer your neighbors the morning off for the week. It's a good ministry. We want to welcome all the people who are online, and one of the things that you can do now, and you can pull that out and actually see the scripture verses right there on the on your phone. If you would, go to the Arbor page and hit like, and that word kind of gets out to everybody. And if you really want to share in the gospel, and you want to be a disciple, and you want to be a missionary, hit share their friendships, and God will reward you. The great thing about it is it plays 24/7. So in the middle of the night somewhere in Africa, somebody's looking to look up Psalms, or they're looking up whatever we're talking about, Ephesians, or it'll bring it up. And so you're ministering the gospel. And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. Okay, we're God kids. How are you today? Good? Well, that's great. You know, yesterday was kind of an interesting day. I had asked your grandmother where she wanted to go eat. She asked me, and I said, Texas Roadhouse. It's out in Chino. And she said, oh, no, we're not going out there. It's too long. And she said, let's go to Costco. We have to go to Costco here in Irvine. I would have gone to one at Texas Roadhouse by Chino, because there's one right next to it. Anyway, I went there, and then all of a sudden we got up there, and she said, let's go to Texas Roadhouse. So on our way, I had mail to drop off in the back, right? And I wasn't going to bring it up to drop off the mail, because that's another stop, and she didn't have breakfast, so she was a little hungry. I know how I am when I get hungry, and I know how you are when you get hungry. It's like that candy bar that, you know, right? Anyway, so she says, oh, you got to turn your mail in? I said, no big deal. She said, go ahead, turn it in. So I veered off the 5, got off on 4th Street, and we went to the Tustin Post Office. Right? Do you know where the Tustin Post Office is? Who knows where the Tustin Post Office is? You do. Yeah, I know you do. You do, right? You know where it is too. Okay. So I'm standing in line, and all of a sudden I feel this arm grab me on the leg. And I look down, and who was it? Carter. Now, the Bakers had never been to the Tustin Post Office before, and the only reason why they were there was at 1:30, they were second in line to get the passport for Harrison. And Hilda was sitting in the car, and all of a sudden, you know, she's in the street, sitting on the car, right, and all of a sudden, bang, bang, bang on the window, and she hit the roof. And it was McKinley. McKinley recognized, they told her parents, that's Grandma's car, or McKinley. So we ended up taking them to Texas Roadhouse, and Chelsea and Curtis said that was actually good, because for 40 minutes we had to wait to go through this whole line. So it was a good thing. The reason why I bring that up is, what do you think heaven's going to be like? What do you think heaven's going to be like, you guys? Heaven is a wonderful place. What do you think it's going to be like? Speechless. Yeah, I know. Okay.
A wonderful place.
Yeah.
Something better than we can imagine.
Something better than we can imagine. Well, you know, yesterday in the post office, when that little arm wrapped around my leg, I was so surprised, and I was pleasantly happy when I looked down, and heaven's going to be 1,000 times better than that, right? Something we can't imagine, right?
Better than any place you can go to in the world.
Better than any place we can go to in the world, and I think one of my grandkids said it's even better than Cancun. And if you know what happens in Cancun, we have a lot of fun there, but that's saying a lot, right?
And then that it's going to be filled with love.
It's going to be filled with love, right? And who are we going to see there?
Jesus. All the people that have died and gone to heaven.
Yeah, anybody you know?
Sweet Grandpa.
Yeah.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Pastor Danny.
Pastor Danny, yeah, he's most certainly going to be there. Boy, I'll bet he's got a ton of questions to ask when he gets up there, right? Anybody else?
God.
Yeah, God, right? So it's going to be a great place. So, in order to go to heaven, what do we have to do?
Believe in Jesus.
Uh-huh, and what else?
Accept Jesus in our hearts and get baptized.
Uh-huh, yeah, right. So,
yeah. Go to the house.
Go to the house, okay. Go to where? Yeah, wrong answer. Okay, come on up. Come on up, Taylor. Okay, we can see the age order here. Okay, so when you guys, are you guys looking forward to Vacation Bible School? What do you do at Vacation Bible School?
You learn more about Jesus.
Uh-huh. What else?
Have fun.
Like, how do you have fun? What do?
Play games.
Play games, and what else?
Dance.
Dance? What else do you do? Oh, boy.
Blow bubbles.
Blow bubbles. Yeah, that's awesome, isn't it? You got to make sure that, where's Ruth? Ruth, where'd you go? There she is. Make sure you have bubbles. Note to self, okay? What else?
I play hazmat.
Okay, yeah?
Have Bible studies.
Bible study, right. Do you guys get to eat anything? Huh? Snacks, okay.
Play games with our snacks.
Yeah, right. So who can come to Vacation Bible School? Okay, we got you down. Who can come to Vacation Bible School?
Anyone, and even if you're not a kid, you can be a helper.
Anyone, and if you're not a kid, you can be a helper. Any helpers out there? Okay, yeah, look at, we've already got helpers. And we need prayer warriors too. So if you can't come, you can pray. We need prayer warriors that God's word will be reached, that the kids' hearts will be opened, and that they'll accept God. And we need to pray for the workers, because there's a tremendous amount of planning. All of those cutouts over there need to be put up, the stage set, and they rehearse, and they do the whole program. Plus, they got to learn, they got to teach the dances, and it's a great time. Thursday night will be a family night, and the whole church is invited to join in and celebrate with the kids, and they'll show what they have learned, right? Anything else about Vacation Bible School you think that our church family should know? Okay, all right. Who's going to open our church, children's church time with a word of prayer? Okay, Kennedy?
Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for all the people that are here. And please let Vacation Bible School go well, and that lots of kids will come and accept Jesus into their hearts. Thank you that this week is 4th of July. Please let us all have a good week and honor and obey you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And all of God's people said? Okay, we have a celebration here, I believe. Somebody has an anniversary. John and Debbie? How many years? 31? 41? All right, 41 years, right? Do we have any other anniversaries or birthdays that we missed? Going once? Going twice? Sold, okay. Happy anniversary, happy anniversary, happy anniversary, happy anniversary. Amen. And all God's people said?
Amen.
Okay, let's join together and continue to worship. We're glad you're here.
I'm going to remind you once again. Now we can turn this down a little bit on the monitor. So I'll check in with my wife. Does this sound a little better now? No, she says. All that work for naught. All right. I remind you every Sunday morning now why our offering plates are up here, and you'll see this Lord's Supper, sitting down here to remind us of what Jesus did for us on the cross and that death, and the offering plate to remind you that it's important for us to give a bit of what God has given to us back to Him. At the beginning of the service, these plates will be here at the end of the service and in the back as you go out, so that you can remember to give. If you're online, there is a place on our online to do that as well. So take some time to do that. Let's sing one more patriotic song to lift things up. I think it's important that we pray even now, even on other Sundays besides a 4th of July celebration, about our country, and ask God to bless it and to take our leaders and guide them through. We've all heard the debate this week, no doubt, and we know that our country is in a quandary about what to do at this moment. We need God's help. Let's keep praying for that. Let's sing God Bless America. Bless America. I truly believe we need to be saying that, praying that over and over again. Cornerstone. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness.
Stormy days.
Obviously, our technical problems this morning are holding us back, but we'll get it straightened out. Marlon's not here today, so we didn't set up early on before. So we're going back to another old hymn here. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing. And then it goes on, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord, the glories of my God and King. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Jesus, the name that calms my fears. Blessed be the name of the Lord. 'Tis music in the sinner's ears. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. We're going to sing the last verse. I never shall forget that day. Blessed be the name of the Lord. When Jesus washed my sins away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name, blessed be the name, blessed be the name of the Lord. So my thought this week was to lift up the name of Jesus and to just praise him along with our patriotic stuff, because I believe in the state of our country and it reflects on us in the state of our lives, and we need to be able to cling on to that one who has the power to help us through all things. Hosanna. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord my God, Hosanna in the highest. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Glory, glory, glory to the King of Kings. Lord, we lift up your name with hearts full of praise. Be exalted, O Lord.
Amen. Thank you, Greg and Audrey, for leading us in worship. And just what a wonderful time to gather together in the house of the Lord and to hear from God's word. And before I read the passage, I just wanted to share that every time I come up here, my responsibility is not to share my thoughts and everything or my words. It's, thus says the Lord. This is what the word of God says for you. And so whenever I try to do my best to stay close to God's word as I possibly can. And today we are going over the last and final walk in Ephesians chapter 5, the last walk. And to be imitators of God is to walk in wisdom. Remember in chapters 1 to 3, Paul is reminding every believer that we have been given every spiritual blessing. Everything that God has given to us, for us, he has given to us generously. And every believer is spiritually wealthy. You have been given everything that you need pertaining to life. And chapters 4 to 5 to 6, again, is because of that wealth, this is how you should walk. And the first walk was walk in a manner worthy of this gospel, or worthy of the calling. It was the first walk. Because you are so wealthy in God and wealthy in the Spirit, it says to walk in a manner worthy of that. The second walk was no longer walk as the Gentiles do. So because you are spiritually wealthy, don't walk like the Gentiles do, who is spiritually poor, and they're impoverished. Even though they may have wealth, the external, but in their spirit, they are poor. And so don't walk as the Gentiles walk. And then 2 weeks ago, we talked about walking in love. To be imitators of God, we walk in love. And then last week, we talked about because we are children of God, we should walk as light. And today is the final of the walk, and that is to walk in wisdom. And it is very important to walk in wisdom. As I said to you before, the reason why most people need counseling is because they are not walking in wisdom. They're walking in the world, or they're walking out of their own selfishness. They are not walking in the wisdom of God. Because when you're walking in the wisdom of God, your life is straight. If you think about the believers who have their life put together, and you see them and you say, man, that guy has his life, or that lady has this, her life put together, for the most part is because she or he is walking in wisdom, in God's wisdom. Whenever we go outside of God's wisdom is when our life becomes trouble. And so today we want to talk about imitating God by walking in wisdom. And so if you're able, can you please rise as I read Ephesians chapter 5, verses 15 to 7. Remember last week we talked about walking as light, as children of light. And to do that, you need to walk in wisdom. Ephesians 5, 15 to 17. Therefore, be careful how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of your time, because the days are evil. So then, do not be foolish. Amen. Amen. Be seated. So the first part of this passage, therefore, because you walk in love, because you walk in light, therefore, be careful how you walk. Be careful how you walk. Because the world is darkness, there's a lot of traps, there's a lot of things that, temptations that can come your way, and so you have to be careful as you walk through this life. Because you never know what kind of temptation is around the corner. For example, when you're walking in a path in a wilderness or like in the mountains, you never know what kind of animal pops up. Mountain lions, bears, you know, all these other things that could just pop up out of nowhere. And so because of that, because we're walking in this dark world, it says be careful how you walk. The word for careful is called blepo. It means to always be watching, to always be looking, to always be aware of your surroundings. I have a guy who is in the military, and in the military, you're always trained to be alert. And so even as a civilian, he's always alert. He walks into a store, he's looking for the exits. He's looking for people that might look suspicious. Whenever he goes to a restaurant, he's always facing the door. So that way he can see who's coming in. He's never like turn his back on the door, because if someone comes in and it's a robber, he can't see. So he's always sitting where he can see the door. And he's always watching, and he's always on alert. And I tell him, don't you get tired doing that? He goes, nope, I'm always alert. And so this is what Paul is trying to tell every believer. There's danger, there's evil, there's temptation, there's wickedness. Be always alert and be always careful by how you walk. When I'm on Facebook, I'm looking at things, all of a sudden there's this bikini picture of a lady or some temptation to look. Be careful of those things. I feel sorry for our children who's growing up in this environment where the world is at their fingertips. Temptation is at their fingertips. And no one can stop them unless we take their phones away. The young people are at a retreat, and our young people from the Filipino church are at a retreat. And the first thing they did was take away all their phones for the weekend. So the kids, I don't know, they might be going crazy, but they took all away their phones. In fact, I work for Heritage Christian School, and they're having a problem with phones in the classroom where they have access to all these things, and so they're thinking about taking all their phones away in class or even just at school, because the phone is such a distraction. And as older people too, we could be distracted by the phone, but be careful that this phone doesn't control your life. And that's just one part, but just be careful how you walk. Be careful, and the word walk means your life and how you live. Be careful how you talk, be careful how you behave, be careful your actions, be careful about everything that you do, because everything that you do reflects who God is. Everything that you do reflects your claim of faith. Everything that you do can destroy your claim of faith. You could say you're a believer to a group of people, but they look at your actions and it doesn't reflect the same thing, and your claim as a believer is down the drain. And that's what Paul was telling the Ephesian church. Hey, you have been given every spiritual blessing and you claim to know Christ, but your life has to reflect that faith. So be careful how you walk. And it says here, not as unwise, but as wise. And we'll go over the unwise and the wise. And what does wise mean? It means knowing what is right and doing it. The wise does not mean intelligence. Like I said before, I know a lot of intelligent people who do the stupidest things. There's a lot of smart people who are in jail right now because of doing some stupid things. So being wise does not mean intelligence. It means knowing what is right and doing what is right. knowing what God's will is and doing what God's will is. And that is wise. Not to be unwise, but to be wise. Because why? To redeem, to make most of your time, because the days are evil. Here in this world, Paul is saying, you only have a short time to be to glorify Christ in your life. Life is short, and because you have Christ in your heart, you only have a short time in your life to live. I think the average lifespan now is a little longer now because of health and all that. We're living healthier and stuff, so we're living a little longer. But even 75 years to us is a long time, but compared to eternity, it's just a short time. And so Paul is saying, now that you know Christ, redeem the time. Make use of your time, because your time here is short. Your time here to glorify Christ in your life is going to end soon. Your time to share God's good news of the gospel is going to end. Your time to serve Christ here on earth is going to end. So be wise and live a life that makes use of your time, because the days are evil. In this dark world, again, we need Christians who live out their faith, who don't hide their faith, because the world, this earth is dark. And it's getting darker and darker and darker as the days, the years, the months go on. But here's the beauty of that. I'm not afraid of it, because as the world gets darker, that means our light for Christ will shine brighter. So as we live for Christ, as this world becomes darker every moment, that means our light, if we live for Christ, is going to shine even brighter. And they're going to take notice of your life. And so Paul is saying, you have this opportunity to live for Christ. Make most of your time and redeem the time, because the days are evil. And one of the things I am guilty of, I waste a lot of time. I waste a lot of precious time by doing almost nothing compared to what I could be doing for the Lord, what I could be doing for the kingdom of God. I think Netflix has been not good for me and my family, because we could binge watch eight straight hours of watching a show from the beginning to the end. Right now, my wife and I, we're into Korean shows, Korean dramas. And we could sit and watch a series of Korean dramas for a long period of time. But Paul is saying, make use of your time, because the days are evil, and we need Christians who are living wise. Then it says, do not be foolish, but understand the will of the Lord is. So for us to be walking in wisdom, we need to know what the will of the Lord is. To be careful how we walk, to live as wise and desire wisdom, and to make use of our time, because we know the day is evil, and so that we do not walk foolishly in this world, and we need to know what the will of the Lord is. Psalms 90:12, I don't have a PowerPoint for it, but it says, so teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts into wisdom. As we count the number of our days, that is a way for us to be wise with our time and wise with our life, knowing that we only have a short period of time. At any time that we can go, we're not promised tomorrow. But the ones who think they're going to live forever, they waste a lot of time. But here in this passage says, if we number our days, and here's what it means to have a heart of wisdom, or heart of the wise. This is the heart of someone who is wise. Proverbs 3:13, how blessed is a man who finds wisdom, and the man who gains understanding. The heart of the wise person is always seeking to find wisdom. to know God's will and to search out God's will and to do God's will. And this person is constantly looking for God's wisdom and God's truth. And how blessed is he who continually tries to find God's truth and God's wisdom, who's always into his word and knowing God's word and knowing God's promises and knowing God's instruction. And he gains understanding. And the only way to do that is through here, by reading your Bible and reading your word. A wise believer, a wise Christian, is always seeking God's will by reading his word. How many believers and Christians who don't even read God's word? And that's why they lack wisdom. They don't know exactly what God wants them to do in certain situations, how God wants them to deal with marriage, conflict, temptation, sin. They don't know what God wants for them. They don't know God's will. And so they don't live in wisdom according to how God designed us. So a person who is a wise person, he's always seeking after wisdom. Proverbs 9:10, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. It says here, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. If you want wisdom, it starts here. The fear of the Lord. And what is this fear? It's not, there's two kinds of fear. There's one that's dread and trembling and like frightened. But there's another fear that's honor, respect, and worthy of honor, like a reverential fear and awe. And so here, this passage is talking about that reverential kind of fear, the kind of awe. Because remember, if you're a believer, there's no more condemnation. And so when you fear the Lord, it's not out of this dread that he's going to condemn us and things like that. The kind of fear that we have now is a reverential fear, a fear to honor him and to do as he pleases. So it starts there. Here is a quote from one of my favorite authors, A.W. Tozer. He said about fear, it says, fear is not a cringing dread before the Lord. It is not a guilt. Oh no, here comes God. I'm in for it now. The fear of the Lord is a reverential and awe-inspiring respect and honor, in openness to him, eager to please him, in all humility, to be instructed by him. The fear of the Lord is a willingness to turn from evil and change. The fear of the Lord is surrender to his will, and the fear of the Lord is one way that we love him. So this awe-inspiring fear is to honor him and revere him. He also goes on to say, the fear of God is astonished reverence. I believe that the reverential fear of God is mixed with love and fascination and astonishment and admiration and devotion to him. That is the beginning of fear of the Lord, and that is the beginning of wisdom. If you don't have the fear of God in your heart, you're not going to find wisdom. You don't have this fear of God in your heart, that my God knows everything. My God is all-powerful, all-knowing. His way is the best way. You don't have this honor for him. Last week, remember, during Father's Day, I asked some shows from back in the days, and there was this one show someone said that I even forgot. He said, Father Knows Best. Remember that? I said, that's right. That is a show from back in the day. Father Knows Best. This is the beginning of wisdom. My Father knows best. I don't know what's best. The person on the internet does not know what's best. The people on Instagram, they don't know what's best. The psychiatrist, the psychologist in this world, they don't know what's best. You know who knows what's best is? My Father knows what's best. That is the fear of the Lord. And that is the beginning of wisdom. Our Heavenly Father is wise. Isaiah 55:8-11. This is what it says. This is God speaking. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than yours, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return there without watering the earth and making it bear fruit and furnishing seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so will my word be which goes forth from my mouth. It will not return to me empty without accomplishing what I desire and without succeeding in the matter for which I sent it. So here, God's ways is higher than our ways. His thoughts are higher than our thoughts, and he's giving us his word. And what this passage is saying, that God is saying, my word is so true and powerful and trustworthy that it's going to do what I planned it for it to do. It's going to accomplish what I said. Whatever I promise will come true. If I say this is going to be the best thing for you, it's the best thing for you. It's always right and it's always perfect. My God knows what's best. Psalms 19, 7 to 8, and I know it's kind of a lot, but the law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing to the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. This is the beginning of wisdom. When you have this kind of heart, knowing that God's way is the perfect way. And God's truth is the perfect truth. It is right, it gives joy to the heart, it is radiant, and it gives light for our path. Remember then, Psalms 119, thy word have your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. It's so radiant. And here's the thing, in this world today, people, even scholars, are trying to discredit God's truth. And they're saying that this Bible is no longer applicable for this life. You can't really trust everything in this Bible, in this book. But for us, this word is perfect, it is true, and it's trustworthy. Everything that you need to know about God and his promises are all in here. And this is a blessing for us. I have this cartoon where this guy is crying out to God, God, what should I do? What do you want me to do? What is your will for my life? And this guy is expecting a verbal, communication. But what happens in the next part of the cartoon is a hand comes down from heaven with a Bible. Here you go. Everything is right here. And what I want to impart to you people, to people of God, to have a high view of God's word in your heart. Fully trust in it. Fully know that whatever God promises is true, and he knows what's best for our life. And we need to go and find truth in there, in God's word. Again, in Psalms 18:30, as for God, his way is perfect. The Lord's word is flawless. He shields all who take refuge in him. And so God's way for your life is the best possible way you can live. This is the God first life. It's the life God intends for you to live. To seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything else will be added unto you. It's just this attitude that, man, I'm going to live God's way. I'm not going to do my own thing. I'm not going to live my own way. Because here's the heart of the fool. Now we're going to go to the fool. Here's the heart of the fool. I want to spend some time on what is a fool. Here's the heart of the fool. Proverbs 12:15. The way of the fool is right in his own eyes. Here's the fool. I do my own thing, I'm right, I don't listen to anybody. No one rules me, no one controls me, I do whatever I want to do. That's the beginning of a heart of a fool. Proverbs 28:26, whoever trusts in his own mind is a fool, but he who walks in wisdom will be delivered. So the first part of being a fool is not having this reverence for God, as found in Romans chapter 1, where it says they knew God, but they did not honor him as God, and so God gave them over to all their sensual desires and the depravity of their minds. Because they don't revere God and thank God, they become fools. They think they're wise, but they actually become fools. The heart of a fool does not honor God, revere God, acknowledge God. They're hostile towards God. They love the darkness and sin. They're prideful, they're selfish in their heart, and they only want to do their own thing. And that is the heart of the fool. And it's so cool because in Proverbs, it talks about five types of fools. That's why I love God's word. Like, in our English language, the word fool can mean so many different things. But in the Bible, it's very clear and very specific. So in the book of Proverbs, it goes over the five types of fools. A fool that does not honor God. And the first one is the simple fool. This is the Hebrew word pethi. The root word from which it is derived, patha, implies extreme vulnerability, literally meaning to be opened up. This fool is one who is always gullible, very simple-minded. He's open to anything. Whatever someone says, he believes it. Whatever someone tells him to do, he'll do it. A very simple-minded person. A simple fool is open to anything, opens his arms to anything, opens his ears to anything, and he lacks discernment. His view of life is oversimplified. He doesn't know the consequences of actions. Like, the simple fool will do whatever someone says. The simple fool is open again to anything, and he is convinced by others to do evil. You know, a lot of people who are like criminals, you know who they look for to help them? The simple fool. They look for people who are like this, that they can convince to do evil. Because the simple fool knows no consequence, and he just does whatever someone tells him. And so a lot of accomplices to a crime are simple fools. And they just do whatever someone says. They have no conviction of their own. They have no wisdom of their own. And so they're swayed by every wind of doctrine or whatever people say. That's a simple fool, very gullible. Do you know some people like that? Very gullible. And if you are a simple fool, man, you are in trouble. You're going to be taken advantage of. You're going to be always in trouble. And a simple fool, he doesn't take advice. He could be swayed by so many things. There's this guy that I know. He's not very smart in buying a car, right? And we knew that if we went to go buy a car by himself, he would be taken advantage of. So we told him, hey, don't go by yourself. Take one of us with you. You know what the simple fool did? He went by himself. He didn't take instruction. He didn't take wisdom. He went to the car dealer, and they asked him, how much can you afford? That's the first question you ask, and you know, as smart, wise people, you don't say a high number. You say a low number. Oh, I could afford maybe 150, 200. This guy, he said, I could afford $550. And they gave him a car. It was a nice car, but this car, it came out to $600 a month. And it wasn't even a car that was worth $600 a month. His interest rate was 15%. That is a simple fool. That doesn't take instruction from people or take advice. He goes in his own way. He does his own thing. And then when we found out, we were so angry with him. And so we helped him. We helped him get another loan online. And so his interest rate from 14, it went down to 6%. And so his payment was from $650 down to three-something, $300. And the wise people helped him out. But that is an example of a simple fool who's so gullible and can be tricked by people. Here's some scripture passages. Proverbs 22:3, this is the simple fool. The prudent sees danger and takes refuge, but the simple keep going and pay the penalty. The simple fool sees danger, but they keep on going. And then they have to pay for it. Proverbs 14:16, a wise man fears and turns from evil, but a fool is careless and reckless. The wise, when they see something and fear, they turn. And they turn from evil, but the simple fool, they're just careless and reckless. The next fool is called the silly fool. The Hebrew word that refers to a silly fool is evel. Its definition is to be perverse and silly. The mouth of the silly fool often gets him into trouble. So this is a silly fool who's like the clown, always using his mouth to tell silly jokes, perverse jokes, lies, deception. His mouth gets him into all kinds of trouble. It's the one that doesn't take anything serious, someone who doesn't take up instruction, and someone who is always going to be in trouble because of his mouth and because of his silly understanding. And he sees nothing wrong with anything. The silly fool, a wise man lay up knowledge, but the mouth of the foolish, evil, is near destruction. Proverbs 27:3, the stone is heavy and the sand is weighty, but a fool's wrath is heavier than them both, evil. So the silly fool is a jokester and all these things, but when he is corrected, there's so much wrath. And he gets offended really easy, and he has no control of his emotions. And so he's always in vengeful or always having heavy wrath. So you don't want to be around the silly fool. There's always trouble that follows the silly fool. Here's some other passages. Proverbs 18:6. A fool's lip walk in a fight, and his mouth invites a beating. So this fool is always in trouble. You know the guy in the bar that runs his mouth, and because he's drunk, he has no control of himself. His mouth invites a beating. His mouth invites a fight. Even this fool is, if you are married to a foolish person who doesn't have control of his or her mouth and what she says or he says, the way he speaks, she speaks, is always inviting a fight. Instead of being a peacemaker, the words of this silly fool always starts a fight and doesn't stop a fight, but makes it even worse and worse and worse and worse. Proverbs 29:9, if a wise man has an argument with a fool, the fool only rages and laughs, and there is no quiet. There's no reasoning with this silly fool. You try to reason with this person, and all they do is laugh at you or get mad at you, and there's no quiet. The silly fool always believes his way is the right way, and so there's no talking to him. There's no talking to him. Some other verses for silly fool. Proverbs 18:7, the fool's mouth is his ruin, and his lips are a snare to his soul. Proverbs 10:23, doing wrong is like a joke to a fool, a veal, but wisdom is pleasure to a man of understanding. So this is the silly fool that has no control of his mouth, his attitude, his emotions, and he's just a a walking time bomb. The third kind of fool is called the sensual fool. This type of fool is identified in scripture with the Hebrew word kesel, which means fat, or stupid, or silly, or sluggish. It's also the word for glutton. This fool has no control of his flesh. Whatever his flesh desires, he gives in to his flesh. Gives in to all his sensualities. And he has no control of his life. And every sin that looks enticing, this fool will always give in. The sensual fool focuses on what which brings him immediate pleasure. Whatever his flesh desires, he gives in. This fool lacks self-discipline and control, and the flesh is in control of his life. People who are in addiction, they're in this category. They're living a foolish life because they're allowing their addiction to control their life. All the sorts of addictions that are around is because these people are allowing their flesh to control them. This fool is always has a problem of idolatry of comfort, lazy, procrastinating, late to work, late to appointments, doesn't fulfill their promises, misses opportunities, lazy, irresponsible, and unreliable. In fact, it says, do not give an assignment to a sensual fool because he will not complete it. Here are some passages for the sensual fool. A fool finds pleasure in wicked schemes, but a person of understanding delights in wisdom. A fool's lips enter into contention, and his mouth calls for strokes or for blows. A fool's mouth is his destruction, and his lips are a snare of his soul. Proverbs 26:3, the whip for the horse, a bridle for the donkey, and a rod for the fool's back. Have you noticed that a lot of times when you allow your body to take over your life, your body is destroyed? The body is attacked. Punishment is always there. Proverbs 19:29, the beatings for the back of a fool's again. So this sensual fool always wants what he wants. And I think I shared the story with you before. My brother, when we were younger, we went to 7-Eleven. I think I shared this with you before, so I apologize. But for those who haven't heard, we were young. I was about maybe 9 or 10. He was about 12. We went to a 7-Eleven, and they had these yo-yos that were really amazing. They light up when you go, and he wanted it so much. And he stole a couple of them. And the store found out. We walked out of the store, and I thought we were fine. Some guy came out, grabbed them by the neck, and pulled them out and pulled them to the back. And then I followed him, and then I realized he took out some yo-yos. And the guy told me to go get your mom, because he goes, where do you live? I live right. Go get your mom. And so because my brother wanted that yo-yo so much, he allowed his flesh to, and the things he desired to control him, and he stole it. Ooh, and my mom, when I talk about a fool's back being broken and beaten, man. I think if that happened today, my mom would be in jail right now. Because back in those days, parents had the right to spank. I remember when I went to a private school, seventh grade, I got expelled from my elementary school at sixth grade. I got expelled for hitting a teacher. Not like a punch, but she grabbed my ear and tried to pull me back in class, and I swiped at her, and I pushed her, kinda. And so I was expelled from sixth grade. And so my mom took me to a private school where my brother and my sister were going, and I sat in the office of the principal, and they gave this paper to my mom. It said, the right to spank. And he said, the principal, he's a big football player, ex-Dallas Cowboy, fullback, and he was the principal, and he gave this paper to mom, and I said, the right to spank. And he said, you need to sign this to give us the right to spank your son. And I'm like, what? Mom, are you going to really sign that? My mom, whoop, without any hesitation, whoop. And you know what cured me of all of my my behavior? Wally the whale. There's a paddle that was shaped like a whale, and it had holes in it, so no wind can't stop it. Big whale, Wally the whale. My mom, you know how my ADD was cured? Wally the whale. You know how my disobedience was cured? Wally the whale. So this is the sensual fool that needs to be broken like that. I was like that. The fourth one, and I know I have to hurry up, the fourth one is a scornful fool. This is a fool that that is a disdain and contempt for God. This fool just doesn't believe in God. He hates God. And he scorns against God, and he has this contempt from God, towards God. Proverbs 13:1, the scorning fool turns a deaf ear to rebuke. A wise son hears his father's instruction, but a scorner heareth not rebuke. So this fool, he has no control. He doesn't listen to anybody. He won't listen to anybody. Even the cops won't listen to the cops. He won't listen to anybody. And he's always going to be in trouble. I'm going to skip a little bit more. Well, I'll share this one. Proverbs 14:6-7. A scoffer seeks wisdom but finds none, but knowledge is easy to one who understands. Leave the presence of a fool, of a scorning fool. Don't even be in their presence, it says. You know how the Bible says, don't give pearls to swine? When you come across a scorning fool, don't even try to give him God's word, because it's